Hello, I'm Julianne Bittner, Tricom CEO, and I'm excited for today's guest. I heard about Will about 3 years ago from Shelley Wilkinson, Director of Sales at Tricom. She was at the Colorado Staffing Association conference, and she comes out and calls me and says, "You got to get this book. The book is phenomenal. The speaker was phenomenal, Will Matthews. And you got this. It's a great book. I bought it right away, read it. I've got all my notes inside of it. I'm reading it for the second time. Watched a couple of videos and said, I have to hire this man for our client conference. So I did that back last year. He came and spoke in Milwaukee. Clients loved you. And so it gives me great pleasure. It's Will Matthews. He's the author of the best-selling book, You've Got This, The 5 Self-Coaching Keys You Need to Live Boldly and Accomplish Anything. I strongly recommend it. As a keynote speaker and board certified coach with over 25 years of real-world corporate leadership and management experience in both energy and technology, Will now speaks nationally to executive groups and many of the staffing associations on the topics of self-leadership, developing emerging leaders, and team excellence. Will blends what he has learned as an Ironman triathlete. Can't say that I can. Not many people can. I'm a half marathoner, but not a triathlete. Business executive and professional development expert to help others break through the results and fulfillment they really want, and the warrior-like determination and skill. So it gives me great pleasure to bring you here today, Will, to have you on this podcast. So thank you, Will.
Yeah, what a pleasure, Julianne, to be with you again. It's always great to be around your energy, and I'm looking forward to our time together today for sure.
Thanks, great. So, you know, we're in these uncertain times. The environment that we're in, nobody has ever worked or had this experience. It's a different lifetime than anything. So what are you seeing in your interactions with leaders and teams that we might be able to learn from?
Yeah, you know what? You're right. I mean, gosh, who would have ever predicted that something like this would be the thing that, you know, really put us as individuals and companies and the country and the world back on our heels so much. I'm amazed when I think about that. And it does highlight the very things that we need to have as leaders. And whether or not, if you're listening or watching, if you are in an actual leadership role or not, please understand, when I talk about leadership, as Julianne shared, the first thing we have to understand is we're all leaders. And, you know, it's about self-leadership first. That's where it all starts. At Matthews Performance Group, my company, and the work that I do, I say this, it's like mindset plus skill set, knowing what to do, plus execution is what creates business success. It's that trifecta, right? Mm-hmm. Mindset is first by design. Because I believe in my heart, having had a chance to work with literally thousands of CEOs and business owners in all kinds of industries and all parts of the world, I've had a chance to be very intimate conversations with people who are leading teams. And Julie, I know you lead a big team there. So you can relate to this. You know, being able to look behind the curtain and say, you know, what's really working? What is differentiating those leaders who are attracting success and sustained success from those who ultimately end up frustrated and disappointed and not doing very well? And so that's what I really like to try to share with people is as I learned these things over these many years of working in this field as a professional development expert, I've recognized certain patterns, certain traits, certain things that great leaders do. It starts with mindset. So during these very difficult times, what I've noticed is in my continued coaching conversations and work that, you know, the things that really make us successful in the good times are only just that much more amplified and needed in these difficult times like this.
Most definitely. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mindset is so, so very important. I agree with you. And I've learned that through the last probably 5 to 6 years more than I had in the past, because when I think I can do something, exactly what you've got this, when you think you can do it, you will achieve it. But when you go into something in business, in personal life, whatever, with the attitude of, I'm not going to do this. I'm going to fail. I don't have this. I don't have the strength. I don't have the ability. you're not going to succeed. It's going to be really tough for you to succeed. It's going to take longer. But I feel when you go in there and saying, I got this. Yeah, I don't have all the answers. That was my big thing in this whole thing is I said to the team, I don't have all the answers, but together we got this. We will fight through this. We will get through this. And don't expect me to have the answers because I can't and I won't because nobody's gone through this before.
Well, Julianne, that one trait right there is one that I've seen replicated in leaders that I work with who are able to create that sustained success. And I do a lot of work with emerging leaders, people who are kind of in their first or second maybe leadership role. They've made the move from individual contributor. My gosh, everybody can remember that move. I know for me, I was an outside salesperson in a remote, non-headquarter role. I got a huge promotion, thankfully, and I was moved to the home office. And the culture shock of having all that flexibility of being an individual contributor, now having really all that goes along with leading a team, was really something else. And I remember exactly where I was thinking, what did I do? Why didn't I just stay in that individual contributor role? But the thing is, what we know is that it's in the leadership side where you can make the bigger impact. So it can be easier to maybe be an individual contributor, but finding what you're made of and how you can grow and stretch and reach to become a great leader is extremely fulfilling, if not also super hard at times too. Mm-hmm. So the mindset part, really, this is interesting because these are the five components of my book that you shared just a moment ago. First and foremost, you've got to be able, I believe, you don't have to, I believe that successful people start with gratitude every time.
Exactly.
And I'm sure you know, I'm sure you believe that, and I see it in you. It's an overwritten about topic now, but I didn't have a choice. It had to be the first chapter in the book because I know that when we come from a place of gratitude, everything else starts to open up. When we come from a place of something other than gratitude, like, why me, or what, I'm not lucky, or look at Bob Jones over there, or Gail White over there, who's got all these things. When we're in comparison trap, we're not bringing our best self, and we don't get our best thoughts, our best ideas.
Right. And even with that gratitude, a lot of times when problems come, when they exist, or we go through a season that's turbulent, like I guess you would call this pretty turbulent, there are unprecedented opportunities in them. We just have to look for them. We don't see them right away because we're like, well, why me? Why am I stuck in this? And we all can be doing that right now. Why does this keep on going on? Why? But there are opportunities that have come through this that we didn't know because we never predicted this would ever happen.
Absolutely. A lot of millionaires were created during the Great Depression. A lot of people are, it's interesting, as tough as times are across the board for people, have you noticed that a lot of companies really are doing quite well right now?
Yes, surprisingly, they are.
Yeah, mm-hmm. So, I'm always searching for that. That's my, I guess my blessing and my curse. And when I look at that dichotomy of what's creating success for people in the same environment that's creating frustration, disappointment, and failure, that's where I light up because I want to understand how we can share that and bring more of the things that we can observe that are helping create leaders out there.
Yeah, as a leader, it's really important now, I think, for us to motivate our staff and to help them see the blessings and the good things, what's coming out of this, and what is the positive that you have versus the negative that's happening. And I keep on telling staff, look at our sales are coming back, clients are doing well again. We're almost back to what we figured it was. We're over last year, so that's great. So you have to look and say, we have jobs. We haven't laid off anybody. So look at those things and look at, okay, what are the good? Not only the bad, because when you focus on that negative, I don't know how you get up in the morning then, because it just keeps on dragging you down.
Yeah, no doubt about that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so quickly, just to round that out for people who might be new to the work here, but so gratitude, number one. Then from the place of gratitude, the second chapter is being a warrior. And now I'm talking about a warrior like striking against someone else, but strong, disciplined, you know, precise, thorough, follow through, all those things that create the kind of a warrior-like determination follow through. Mm-hmm. The third, and this is super important right now, is being able to master resiliency. And that's the key to the kingdom right now. You know, if, when things like this happen, I'm going to read a quote from Walter Wintel, one of my favorite quotes. Back in the early 1900s, he says, "If you think you're beaten, you are. If you think you dare not, you don't. If you'd like to win, but you think you can't, it's almost certain you won't. If you think you'll lose, you've lost. For out in this world, we find that success begins with a person's will. It's all a state of mind." And wow. I believe that is one of my favorite, if anybody's interested, is Walter Wintel, W-I-N-T-L-E. It's a poem called Thinking. And that's an excerpt from it. But anyway, my point is this: warrior-like determination, resiliency, learning how to be able to bounce back up. There's a quote from a movie, Creed, one of the Rocky movies, toward, you know, more recent. And the line, I love this, is, "In life, it's not how hard a hit, it's not how hard you can hit, it's how hard a hit you can take." And we've all taken a lot of hits. Whether this time has actually affected you or your family physically, you know, I could tell you, each and every one of us has been affected mentally and emotionally.
Oh, definitely. And
yeah, I'm sure you see that too in what you're working, the things you're working on and the people you're working with.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, it's just challenging to watch. It's hard sometimes when you see people who are struggling, you know, some of the companies that didn't make it because they're in, you know, hospitality, and that's gone. And you feel so terrible for them. And you're like, yeah, what can you repivot? How can you pivot that business and put it into a different model? And the struggling with that. So, and it's just, it's hard, even for, as us, as we're talking with them, you know, it's hard to not get emotional about it.
Absolutely. Yeah, you're right. Certainly one of the most absolutely devastated industries possible.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Some of my favorite people to work with, because they're so much about giving and creating experiences for people. And
exactly.
It's really tough. That actually is a huge segue. The fourth key then is learning and understanding when you need to reinvent. When you being open to reinventing yourself again and again and again. Mm-hmm. Because sometimes it's about bounce back, like resiliency. But other times, like for as in your example, there are a lot of people in that industry who have to reinvent themselves now. And we have some people are very open to that right away. It's just very easy to say, "Oh, I'll just go do something new." And for others, it's extremely difficult. So embracing, you know, I can find ways to reinvent myself, and I can embrace that.
Right. I don't know if you've listened to Craig Groeschel. I do the leadership training in September with them, the global leadership. And he talked about leading through the dip back in August, I think the presentation was. And he was talking about four different things. One was changing your mindset and on change, that not everybody, they don't always hate it. It's more about how we deliver change, you know? If we deliver it in a way to show them the positive of it, why we have to do this instead of forcing it down them, then they'll be more apt to embrace change. So that was one of them. Have the courage to unmake promises. As leaders, sometimes we're like, we are never going to change this. I said for years, we'll never work from home. And now I have only 20 people working in an office where we used to have like 50 people. So I'm working from home. So it's very different. He also said, obsess about the why. Why this? How can we change it? You know, and then lead with uncertainty. Lead with confident uncertainty. So those four things I really took from in August and said, okay, how do I expand on that? So it really talks about what you were your fourth point, you know, change, uncertainty, and just leading through that.
Right. Yeah, there's another great quote that comes to mind when you say that, and that is, the quality of your life and the level of your success is in direct proportion to the amount of uncertainty you can comfortably tolerate.
Boy, that's true.
Yeah. So yeah, you're right on point with that. The fifth then, just to round that part out, the fifth is knowing when to trust, how to trust and let go. And it has to do with you know, if gratitude is the start of this process about releasing into knowing that, you know, I always say compared to what, and it sometimes seems harsh, but no matter what someone's going through, it's tough. Of course it is, but compared to what, you know, compared to the mother in Africa who is walking 3 miles to get some water to bring home, you know, to give to her kids, and maybe they don't have, you know, literally anything to eat. You know, I bring that up as a very extreme example because we can see our own challenges and problems, and I'm very empathetic toward those for everybody, as being just huge. And then when you really think about that analogy or that comparison, you know, compared to someone who's really struggling, like you said, hey, you haven't had to lay off anybody. We've had businesses growing. But even if somebody's lost their job, you know, and that's devastating, then, you know, still compared to someone else on this planet, these problems seem to be somewhat more able to be overcome. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense for you?
Yep, definitely.
Yeah. So learning when to, you know, so that's the gratitude part. Then at the end, you know, learning how to trust and let go. You know, there's times where, you know, in sales, and, you know, we're all salespeople as well. We're all leaders. We're all selling at some level. Mm-hmm. You know, finding that strength to, one of the biggest shifts I've seen create success in sales when you stop chasing and start allowing. And of course, you know, you want to be out there working hard. That's not the point. Right, we want to be doing the work.
Right.
But have you ever had that sense or seen people who have where they're just, you know, they're just chasing, like, what, you know, they're on the hunt. And it's funny, sometimes when you just allow yourself to go, you know what, I'm going to do all the right things, but I'm also going to open my mind to allowing the opportunities to close, mm-hmm. allowing them to come in rather than me thinking I have to drive each and every step of that.
Wow. Really good. That's great information. And I love you went over those five steps because they're so valid. They're so important. They really are. So right now we've got people struggling either because of the direct health, what happened to them, because maybe they are fighting through COVID, family members are fighting through COVID, lifestyle or financial challenges resulting from this pandemic. Some of us have been fortunate to have no experience directly by the financial impact of this or any health challenges. So for both of those groups, are there any ideas that you can share which might help make these next several months better, you know, on both sides of the table?
Yeah, that's a great question. You know, being willing to access your own personal power, you know, we are constantly in this moment and in every moment, Juliana, at the crossroads of choice. Always we're at choice. And, you know, reinventing yourself is a choice, and getting back up when you've taken a hard hit, that's a choice. Settling for less or claiming that you're not able to find solutions is a choice as well. Now, living in fear, living in doubt, allowing self-doubt to take over is at the end, it's just a choice, as is being brave and being bold and summoning that confidence. That's a choice that we make. Mm-hmm. It's our choice to be unstoppable. It's our choice to be able to power through. It's our choice to be able to find solutions where they might seem evasive. And testing your own limits is a choice as well. Mm-hmm. So my point here is to say, look, no matter what's happening, no matter where you need to go, and no matter how far a chasm or a canyon it seems like you're here, you need to get over here, there is a way to do that. And it starts again with that mindset. And if you need to change your skill set and get better, or change your career or whatever it happens to be, and to get new skills and get them, and then execute, you know, it's just that simple. To understand that you, whoever's listening, are at a point of choice right now, whether things are going well or whether things are really devastating, and you, within you, have the ability to find that solution and move through. So there's a lot of different ways to kind of go about that, but right now, in every second of every day, you know, there are big decisions that you have got to make, and only you can make them. And you can play small or you can decide to live large. And you can fit in or you can decide to stand out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can, I notice that in these times right now, you know, people, when things are going well, all their chips are in the middle, so to speak, just like on the poker table. You got all your chips in, or when you start a new job or whatever. And when things get tough, slowly, without even knowing it, people start to kind of pull one chip out, pull another chip out. They lose their intensity. They lose the drive that comes from something fresh and new. And then before long, you realize that not only do they no longer have all their chips in, they kind of got all their chips out. They're actually kind of just going through the motions. And it's a choice to go back and push all those chips back in and say, look, I've got to give it my all to find this new solution, and I will.
Wow, great analogy. Great analogy for chips on a poker table. Yeah, I love it. I love it. I find sometimes, you know, you and I seem to have that ability to get us through the negative times or the problems and look at, I mean, I'm not saying there are days, there has been a day or two where I'm like, boy, I feel beat up. I feel real beat up. But we have the ability to kind of get through that on our own, you know, take a day and go, hey, wait a second. Let's look at all the things positive that I should be thankful for and give gratitude and then move forward and know that I have the ability to do it. I think we're the ones that can help others who don't have that ability that strong. I mean, is there any help you can give us as leaders to give help to others who don't have that tendency to fight through as easily? They just really, no, it's not that, it's me, woe is me. And, you know, that mentality.
Yeah, it's a great point. You know, some people have a natural kind of built-in tendency to look at, you know, look at whatever situation and immediately their mind goes to how do we win on this situation, and other people are not wired that way. I teach a course called Relationship Science, which is all about these basic, if you will, you're probably taking your share of assessments in your career,
right?
I'm a huge DISC and motivators assessment person, so I gravitate toward that. But you know, if you've taken those assessments and gone a little bit deeper, you realize that the value of those is to understand how you are wired.
Right.
But the real value, the real accelerator, is how you can, if you take the time to learn, how other people on your team specifically and your customers and your prospects, being able to identify how they're wired and what that means, how you can tailor your approach in order to be able to build rapport with them, to support them. So, you know, for you and I, as you share it, I think you're right. We are on the same page there. Mm-hmm. You know, the challenge is there, and immediately it's like, what do I got to do?
Right.
Let's go do it. For other people, change. Change is their number one fear.
Mm-hmm.
For their number one concern. And you have people on your team, whoever's listening to this podcast and watching, you have people on your team or in your family, in your group of friends, in your client base who have different concerns and fears and strengths and approaches to conflict and things than you do. And when you break rapport, you know, that's what I try to help people out. Because when we break rapport, think about in your personal life, it can take a long time to build that back, can't it?
Right. Oh, yeah.
And so if we can avoid that, that's pretty good. My point, to answer your question, there are people on your team, Julianne, who are wired differently and whose biggest fear is change and instability. And you know, not having clarity. So what do you do with that? Well, if you recognize that, then you can address, you can have your conversation with them about the upcoming changes in a different way than you would to someone else who's wired kind of like you are.
Right.
Does that make sense?
Oh, totally. Totally. We've done the DISC and I'm strong advocate for it. It's great. Never thought I should be looking at that again because I've had it charted with the whole group.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I'm a DI. Of course I'm a DI. High DI.
You are.
So to understand those other ones, and I know you can flex and go into another area, but understanding where they're wired and then changing my perspective or my approach to the approach that needs their, because of how they're wired. It's so true. And I probably should be pulling that out again and going, okay, now, or even asking, you know, what keeps you up at night right now? What are you challenged by? Besides, yeah, for salespeople, they can't, you know, they're not getting into the customer because nobody wants to make change right now. You know? Okay, what else are you challenged by? And just give me an open, just tell me the truth. And let's just dialogue over that, so that I can understand what you're challenged by, and together we can probably solve it.
Yeah, love that. Yes.
Yeah.
That's beautiful. Yeah. It, yeah. So recognizing those differences is one of the ways, that, and I believe it's a true leadership characteristic, to understand who you are, right. and go to that level and understand how to, like you've just described, how to understand, how to tailor your approach to meet the needs of other people, even in the pace of your conversation, you know. Mm-hmm. There's a high D, you're gonna, you know, you want to get right, probably right to business. You're a very caring person, I know that. If somebody pops into your office when we have those, right. you really want to know, what can I do for you? What do you need? What's, you know, first? And then when the business is taken care of, you might be more comfortable. Hey, how's the family or whatever?
Right.
Well, other people are the opposite. They can't even get to business first until they've had some sense of personal connection. And mm-hmm. that one little tweak can help that person on your team feel that you understand them and that you've taken the time to understand them. It makes a big difference in loyalty and all those things that I know you're good at. So yeah, people look for two things in leaders. They look for empathy and expertise. Mm-hmm. It's the same with sales in sales. The customers are looking for those two things. Empathy, do you understand what it's like to be in my shoes? Mm-hmm. My change, have you taken the time? And secondly, expertise. So once you, and it's in that order. So once you have that, you know, once they feel like you really care and you really have their best interest in mind, and by the way, something that honestly, I think Tricom is so good at that. I know many people in your organization, and it's truly, you and your company do such good work in trying to make sure you really understand what's going on for your clients and prospects, and it's very, very evident. So once that box is checked, then they look at, do you have the goods? Mm-hmm. Now, can you actually get me where I need to go? Can you and your company do what I need to do? So if there's even one, if there's only one takeaway from today for leaders and people out there in customer facing roles, just remember that those are the two things that people are looking for from you: empathy and expertise.
Excellent. Great idea. Great advice. Really great advice. I don't know. What else would you like to share? Anything else that you think that today is really a good opportunity for you to share? Besides, if they haven't bought your book, they need to buy your book.
Amazon.
The other thing I was going to say is your three questions to start the day or a meeting. I love those three questions. I would like you to explain those a little bit, because I have my little sticker on my computer. I look at it, because I really think that's important to get in check. It's my energy level, my focus, and positive expectation. So do you want to take a minute to talk about that? Because I think it's great.
Yeah, I do like to think that one of the things that makes life a little easier is when you have some structure around how to do things. Because, you know, we wake up some days ready to go, where our biorhythms are, you know, mentally, emotionally, physically, spiritually, even we're at a 10 out of 10 and we're ready to take on the world and everything just happens beautifully. We love those days. Who doesn't? Right.
Right.
Other days, our biorhythms, if you don't know what those are, you can read up on it for those watching. I know Julianne does, but sometimes those are all, excuse me, those are all very, very low. We don't have any physical strength. One second. Our throat's not working, but you know, our mindset is off. Maybe we're struggling emotionally. We've had something happen that's knocked us back. Physically, we're just not feeling well. But it turns out the world doesn't really care about that. It's brutal, but the world cares about results. So even on those days when you don't feel like it, you've got to figure out. I find that one of the keys to success is finding that strength and that attitude that says, I'll find what I need to do a good job today. We only have 365 days a year. You can't let half of those go by because you just weren't feeling it, right?
Right.
You can't, but then you're going to have about half the results you would have otherwise, mm-hmm. right? So how do you do that? Well, as you shared, that one of the models is this. It's like, where are you in terms of energy? It's becoming aware The awareness is the first step, because then once you're aware of where you are, these three things, then you can start to say, good, how do I knock it up another notch or two? Mm-hmm. How can I take it from a six, if that's where I am for my energy, to an eight? What would I have to do? And you'll find the answers. Your brain will search and find those answers. So number one is energy. How much energy do I have? Number two is focus, as you shared. Because you can have all the energy in the world, but if you don't have focus, then you're kind of like a ping pong ball bouncing all around the room, you know, over caffeinated and just freaking out. But when you have energy and focus on where you're going, clarity about what you're there to accomplish, that's real strength. And the third, and I believe the most important, Julianne, is the third of the three, is positive expectation. A positive expectation that things are going to go your way. Mm-hmm. I believe as leaders and as sales professionals and whatever your role is out there in the business world and in your personal life, by the way, that expecting people to pull through for you is one of the great gifts you can give yourself. It takes a leap of faith. They're not always going to do it, but you don't control that. What you can control is your level of expectation that people are going to treat you right, that people are going to pull through for you, that your team, your clients, your prospects are going to be there and support you. When you do that, it's funny. Have you ever noticed that whatever you put your focus on, you tend to see more of and get more of?
Right. Definitely.
Yeah.
Definitely.
So when you have a focus on positive expectation that this is going to go well, this next meeting is going to go well, this sales conversation is going to go well, the chances of that happening for you go up as well. So energy, focus, positive expectation are the three ways to start a day or a meeting.
I really think those three things come out of, now I'm going to take it over to the athletic side, being an athlete, being a triathlete or whatever, because I remember doing my first half marathon, you had to wake up and go, okay, I got the energy for this. I am a 10 today. My focus is that whole thing, 1 mile at a time, one, you know, because when you look at, oh my God, how many miles am I running today? You're not going to do it, right? And then that whole, being positive. I got this. And I remember that my first one going, I got this. So the whole thing, just, I got this. And when there was times where I don't have it, go, no, change your mental, put your emotions back and say, no, I got this. And you can take that and just apply that in your business world and personal life. So.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I bet you that's what, you know, probably all those darn Olympic athletes, those strong athletes, they have to have those three things very high.
Yeah, absolutely.
They
yeah.
have to, so.
Yeah. Yeah, I've noticed that, you know, in the triathlons and the Ironman competitions I've done, which, you know, some people will do Ironman competitions, some won't. It's not that. We all have an Ironman. We're all looking at something that we don't know if we can do it, but we have to because of circumstances, or we just decide to. So I'm equally impressed, Julianne, by the people who will stand on the podium at the end of an Ironman, I'm also impressed with the people who show up not even knowing if they can complete the thing.
Right.
You know, and it's same in our business world. Again, I believe we all have an Ironman we're working on, and you know. It's great to win, but just showing up is a big part of it. And I so admire the single mother who might have not slept all night, up with maybe a sick child or something, but still shows up on time, maybe even early, never really, you know, lets that get her down. She's pooped, exhausted, spent, but shows up and does her job well. Or the soldier who comes back from a war and struggling with the effects of war with PTSD, but you know what? Still finds a way to make it through. Each and every one of these people are Ironman athletes.
Definitely,
we all are. And you know, I can tell you that standing at the starting point of an Ironman is if you don't know, triathlons are for those watching: swim, you swim, then you bike, and then you run. So you're in these wetsuits typically, and there's people all around you. And, you know, you're waiting for the gun to go off so you can jump in the water and start this thing. You know, it's a big day. And you see around all these people, hundreds of people typically, and all kinds of body shapes and sizes.
Right.
All kinds of ages. You can tell that each one has a story. but they have one common denominator, and they've chosen to do something they didn't know if they could do. And they've chosen to show up and do that. And it makes, I always say that when I see that, it makes my soul smile to see these people showing up and ready to dive in and really take it on. Again, not always knowing if they can pull it off.
Right. I remember thinking that at the first half marathon, and I think it every time I'm running is looking at people going, they're in their 80s, or they're way overweight, but they don't care. They're going to fight through it, even if they have to walk part of it, because it's not about how you finished. It's the fact that you finished. Yes. And it's not about the time. I never think, oh, I got to be the top, or I got to be the top in my age bracket. It's right. About getting out there and completing it and finishing what I set my mind to do. And I think that's what they do. They show up. They show up, and they're going to finish it no matter what. And it's fun to sit back and wait at the end for those last people to come by and to get like a half mile before the end of the finish line and cheer them on. I mean, because when you're running any of the events, people who you don't even know are like, you got this, come on. I did the Tough Mudder this last year.
All right.
Never thought I would do a Tough Mudder, and I did that's the long awesome. One. And people would say, come here, I'll help, you know, get up stuff that there's no way I could get up, you know? And when I was like, oh no, and they're like, you got this. Younger kids just telling me, you got this. I didn't know them. So it's showing up and just completing it, no matter how hard it is and how bad it may look when you finish the line and get across that line, going through that shock treatment at the end, and going, oh my God, why did I do this?
Yeah.
It's really, I mean, those are life lessons that you look around and go, wow, we all just showed up and we just are going to do it, and you're going to help each other get through it.
That's beautiful. Yeah. Yeah. It, you know, you mentioned the idea of the words that you say to yourself. You know, in your case, you said, I've got this. I'm going to make it happen. You know, I believe that there's a lot of power in our words. I believe maybe as a final takeaway, if you're looking to snap back from a setback right now or these difficult times, and you're looking for the edge, you're looking for where you can put your focus when you feel a little bit like a light hitting a prism, you don't know what to do. You know, these can be overwhelming times, and they could be really tough. And when we feel threatened, when we feel in a place of being vulnerable, we can move into the fight or flight mode. You know, it's the amygdala part of the brain where, you know, it's there to serve us when we were getting chased by a lion or something. But we still access that now, even though not a lot of people getting chased by lions. And when we're in that fight or flight, we don't make great decisions. By design, it moves our focus away from our frontal cortex, where our real good strategic decisions come from. So we want to find a way to get back to that. And I would say this, if you're looking to rebound, sometimes, let's just say that, in your company, those watching, maybe you're way behind on your sales numbers, or maybe as personally, you've got so much to do that you don't even know where to start. I always equate it to, you know, if you back where we were in college or high school, and you go down to South Florida for spring break, and maybe you stay there just a little bit longer than you were supposed to, then you come back, and now you've got all these assignments you haven't done. You're way behind the eight ball. You're probably not feeling 100%, and every day you're getting a new assignment that you need to do too. And you might, might be tempted to look at it and go, I can't do it. So rather than try to look at that big picture, your year-end sales quota goal, your end of quarter goal, all the things you need to do to wrap up the year, performance evaluations might be one of those things if you're leading. Instead of thinking about how do I get all these done, think about this. How can I do just a little bit better today than I did yesterday? How can I make three more sales calls today, even though I don't feel like it? Three more than I made yesterday. How can I do one performance review preparation rather than focus on the 15 I have to do? You know, it's great. We like to think that every day we could have Maserati kind of performance, you know, put the key in the car. Great. It's running beautifully. It's got great fuel and down the road you go. But some days, especially when you're kind of rebounding, it might be more like you're sitting behind a 1973 barely running Corolla steering wheel. And you have to know what to do with that. And the goal, you'll have a Maserati days again, but the goal can be instead, how can I do just a little bit more, at least, than I did yesterday? And pretty soon you'll find that that overwhelm has been right-sized and you've gotten back on track.
Wow. Wow. Great way to wrap things up. Great message. That was phenomenal. So thank you. Thank you, Will. It was great spending this time with you. And thank you for sharing all your insight that will help leaders today and tomorrow. I really appreciate it. I hope you have a nice holiday season and stay healthy and safe, please.
Absolutely. You too.
And family. Thank you.
It's always so great to see you too. So live it up. Stay warm as we get into winter. And if there are any folks out there who are looking at building their own leadership skills up a little bit, there is a program I've made available, online course called the Instant Warrior Emerging Leader Edition. So if you like, we can share some information on that. But it's a on-demand, kind of consume it as your time allows kind of a program to help emerging leaders start to become rock stars.
Perfect. Perfect. Thank you. And get that book, right? Purchase your book because it's a great book. And if you haven't read it for a while, bring it back out and read it again because it always is great just to get a refresher on things, put your mind back on focus. So thank you very much, Will. I appreciate your time.
You bet, Julianne. You're the best.
Great to see you. All right. Thank you.
See you later. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.